This is the VOA Special English Education Report. We had a question from China, from a listener who wanted to know about John Dewey. John Dewey was an influential thinker and educator. The New York Times once called him America's philosopher. Larry Hickman is director of the Center for Dewey Studies at Southern Illinois University, Carbondale. He was not surprised that the question came from China. Mr. Hickman told us he just returned from 2 weeks of meetings in Beijing in December. He and Chinese educators discussed the close relationship between Dewey's ideas and those of Confucius. He also worked with a group of Buddhists who like Dewey's work very much because it goes along with some of the ideas of Mahayana Buddhism. John Dewey described his ideas in books including Democracy and Education, The School and Society, and How We Think. Mr. Hickman said Dewey was perhaps the best-known philosopher, educator, and public intellectual of the 20th century. He was active in many fields, including education, philosophy, psychology, and humanistic and humanitarian affairs. He was an important influence in the founding of the American Association of University Professors and the American Civil Liberties Union. He was also influential in the founding of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, although he himself was white. John Dewey was born in Burlington, Vermont in 1859. He was influenced by the scientific work of Charles Darwin. He was also influenced by the work done with immigrant English learners in Chicago by Jane Addams. She was a social worker and the first American woman to win the Nobel Peace Prize. And Dewey was influenced by observing his own children. At the University of Chicago, he founded the Laboratory School. But Dewey would likely have disagreed with many current practices in American education, like the wide use of standardized testing. Larry Hickman said Dewey thought that testing had its place, but that testing should be more like medical tests. They should be testing for individual needs, interests, and abilities, and not to compare one student to another. John Dewey died in 1952, but Dewey scholar Larry Hickman says his ideas are still being taught in education schools. And that's the VOA Special English Education Report.
This is the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. Florida, in the southeastern United States, is called the Sunshine State. It grows more oranges than any place except Brazil. But in January, extremely cold air damaged some Florida oranges and strawberries and killed fish at tropical fish farms. The unusually long period of cold weather has shown how even warm climates can sometimes freeze over. But protecting plants and trees in the garden may not be too difficult if you follow a few suggestions. Sudden cold can be the biggest threat, especially after a warm period. Plants have not had a chance to harden their defenses. Those that are actively growing or flowering are at high risk. Try to choose plants that live best with cold weather and plant them in areas that face west and south. Being near other growth may also provide warmth. Most frost damage takes place at night. Ice crystals form on the leaf surface. They pull moisture from the leaves and keep plant tissues from getting water. Cold weather is most likely to damage or kill plants that do not have enough moisture. So keep the garden watered. Moist soil absorbs more heat than loose, dry soil covered with mulch or vegetation. University of Arizona Extension experts say covering plants and small trees with cloth or paper can help prevent frost damage. A 100-watt light bulb designed for outdoor use can also provide warmth. Some people place Christmas lights on young trees for warmth. The bulbs should hang below the leaves to let the heat rise into the tree. Cold is especially dangerous to citrus trees. Agricultural specialists at the University of California suggest putting paper or cloth around the trunk and central branches of young citrus trees. In Florida, as temperatures fell to record lows, citrus growers sprayed water on their trees to help prevent freeze damage. Jim Botcher is a master gardener with the University of Florida Extension. He explains that as the water freezes, it produces heat, and the ice forms a protective blanket around the tree. If you spray a tree, keep the water away from nearby power lines. Heavy ice can form and break them. You can also wrap a tree in palm tree frond leaves, corn stalks, or fiberglass. Adding plastic film works well in rain and snow. But experts say plastic alone does not help much. And that's the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. More gardening and agricultural advice is at voaspecialenglish.com.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Education Report in Special English. Recently, we told you how some medical schools in the United States offer future doctors a way to finish in 3 years instead of four. Some law schools also offer a way to save a year. People who want to become lawyers traditionally attend 3 years of law school. Like medical students, many law students are deeply in debt by the time they finish their Juris Doctor or JD degree. Those who take out loans borrow an average of around $100,000. Almost all graduates must pass a state bar examination to get a license to practice law. New York University Law School professor Samuel Erstreicher thinks more students should be allowed to take the bar exam after 2 years of classes. This was more common in the past. Supreme Court Justice Benjamin Cardozo and President Franklin Roosevelt both took the bar exam after 2 years. Professor Erstreicher also suggests a more professional instead of a more academic program of study. Learning more about professional skills, he says, would better prepare a lawyer to serve the needs of average Americans. Some law schools offer a choice of a 2 or 3 year program. In 2009, Northwestern University School of Law in Chicago became the country's first top law school to add an accelerated program. Accelerated students at Northwestern have to learn the same material and pay the same price as 3 year students. Some lawyers argue against accelerated programs. They question whether many law firms would want to hire lawyers without that third year of law school. For VOA Learning English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Education Report. Outdoors in the open air seems like a natural place to study natural science. It also makes sense in a place like Southern California, where people like to be outside a lot. Now, the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles County has redesigned an outdoor space into a living exhibit. The 1.5 hectare area used to include a parking lot. Now it welcomes birds, butterflies, and many other living things. Teacher Eva Eng has visited the museum's outdoor campus with her students. She says they enjoyed the experience. The children were learning about plant science in school. Museum scientists come outside to describe plants and insects in the natural setting of this outdoor laboratory. Greg Pauly studies turtles. He tells students how urban development has changed the habitat of turtles like the western pond turtle. He says these animals are happiest around small bodies of water that grow and shrink with the seasons. Today, with development, there is much more permanent water, like the pond at the Natural History Museum itself. The scientist says the changing habitat is one reason why western pond turtles are disappearing. In addition to science lessons, the open-air exhibit provides contact with nature in a way that city children rarely get. Landscape architect Mia Lair says children can get real-life answers to questions they may have. Outdoor classrooms help students understand how the natural world is interconnected and how living things need habitat to survive. Museum official Karen Wise says the whole museum is opening up to an indoor-outdoor experience. For VOA Learning English, I'm Laurel Bowman.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. Professors have lectured for centuries. But how effective is lecturing to students compared to working with them? A new study compared two classes of a beginning physics course at the University of British Columbia in Canada. There were more than 260 students in each section. Both were taught by popular and experienced professors. The study took place for 1 week near the end of the year. One class continued to be taught in the traditional lecture style. The other professor was replaced by two teachers. They had little teaching experience, but received training in interactive teaching methods. The training was led by Carl Wieman, a Nobel Prize-winning physicist who leads a science education program. There was almost no lecturing. The teachers put the students in small groups to discuss and answer questions. The instructors always gave feedback after the groups did tasks, and they gave readings and quizzes to finish before class so the students would come prepared to discuss the material. Professor Wieman says there was a great deal of data showing how identical these two large sections of the class were before the study. At the end of the experiment, both classes took the same test. Students in the interactive class scored nearly twice as high as those in the traditional class. Attendance also increased that week. Graduate student Ellen Chelou was one of the teachers. She says the methods they used are designed to encourage students to think like scientists. The study appeared in May in the journal Science. It seems to confirm earlier findings about lecturing to large classes. But some experts have criticized the way the study was done. Both of the researchers who taught the class, Ms. Chelou and Louis Delaurier, were also authors of the study. This could raise questions about whether their involvement might have influenced the results. Professor Wieman is currently on leave from the University of British Columbia and the University of Colorado. He is the Associate Director for Science in the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy. He says research has shown better ways to teach based on evidence about how the brain learns. And he hopes more professors will learn that how someone teaches may be more important than who does the teaching. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. You can find a link to the physics test that the students took at voaspecialenglish.com. I'm Alex Villarreal with the VOA Special English Education Report. The Program for International Student Assessment, or PISA, is a 2-hour test that compares the performance of 15-year-olds. In the latest test, the countries with the best readers were South Korea and Finland. But students in Shanghai, China, scored the highest of all in reading, mathematics, and science. The next strongest results were in Hong Kong, Singapore, Canada, New Zealand, and Japan. In all, around 500,000 students in more than 70 economies took the test in 2009. The test has been given every 3 years since 2000. Shanghai took part for the first time in 2009. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development released the results. Andreas Schleicher is director of the Education Indicators and Analysis Division at the OECD. He says Asian countries value education more than other countries. They have given education a priority. Every child, every teacher, every parent knows that education is the gateway to success. Mr. Schleicher says other education systems can learn from Shanghai. For example, He says education spending in the province has increased, including teacher pay and training. And administrators are putting teachers into challenging classroom situations to make them better at their jobs. In the PISA scoring system, Shanghai scored 600 in math. By comparison, the United States scored 487. Shanghai's reading average was 556. American 15-year-olds scored 500, the same as in Iceland and Poland. In science, Finland was second behind Shanghai. The United States was 23rd. Education Secretary Arnie Duncan says the results show an urgent need for Americans to do more to remain competitive in the world economy. He points out that the United States has fallen from first to ninth place in college graduation rates because of gains by other countries. Mr. Schleicher says international testing experts have investigated and confirmed the Shanghai scores. He says the PISA results are not representative of all of China. But he also says they dispute the common belief that Chinese education is centered on repetition and memorization. 25% of the Shanghai students showed advanced thinking skills to solve difficult math problems. The OECD average was 3%. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. This is the VOA Special English Education Report. Public schools in the United States have to be neutral about religion, even though they close for holidays like Christmas. The Constitution separates religion from government. Researcher Charles Haynes explains what it says. He says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Those 16 words provide the framework for how we deal with religion in our public schools. Those words are part of the First Amendment, which guarantees freedom of expression and other rights. Charles Haynes is a senior scholar at the First Amendment Center, a group that studies free expression issues. In the last generation or so, different groups have encouraged public schools to celebrate diversity and cultural differences. At the same time, courts have ruled against any publicly supported celebrations of one religion over another. Charles Haynes thinks the schools are generally doing a good job. He says, "So public schools now, I think, understand that their role is to expose students to learning about different religions in a fair way, an objective way. Their role is to protect the religious liberty rights of students. If they want to express their faith, they may do so. But school officials under the First Amendment may not take sides in religion." Holly Jones teaches 6-year-olds at a public school in Loudoun County, Virginia. Each December, she has her students make posters about their own celebrations at home and present them to the class. The posters are discussed and then shown on the walls at the school. Ms. Jones says, "Some students will do Hanukkah, some Kwanzaa, some Christmas. Some we've had in the past do the Chinese New Year. Some children come from families with more than one religion. Holly Jones says the children always ask lots of questions about the traditions of other families. She says this gives them an understanding about how different and diverse the students are. And Charles Haynes says that is one of the purposes of public education in America. And that's the VOA Special English Education Report, written by Nancy Steinbach. You can find transcripts and podcasts of our reports, and you can post comments at voaspecialenglish.com. And you can find us on Twitter and YouTube at VOA Learning English.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Education Report. American librarians have announced their choices for best children's books of 2014. One honored book is the story of a squirrel and an imaginative girl. Another is about trains. Deborah Taylor is a librarian at the Enoch Pratt Free Library in Baltimore, Maryland. She has served on several award committees. She says the committees look for good writing and good storytelling. The American Library Association's John Newbery Medal honors the writing of a book. Its Randolph Caldecott Medal honors the illustration or pictures of a book. This year, the Newbery Medal went to Flora and Ulysses, The Illuminated Adventures by Kate DiCamillo. It was her second work to win a Newbery. Flora and Ulysses is a humorous story about a squirrel and a girl who live in a world both real and unreal. The Caldecott Medal was awarded to Locomotive, a book by Brian Floca. It has been praised for its technical understanding and explanations of how things happen on a moving train. Librarians also give out other awards to books for children and young adults. For example, the Coretta Scott King Award goes to African American writers and illustrators for books about African American culture. This year's award went to Rita Williams Garcia for her book P.S. B11. The Robert F. Seibert Medal is for informational books. Parrots Over Puerto Rico by Susan Roth and Cindy Trumbore won the 2014 medal. Their book tells about how scientists and activists saved the local birds. Librarian Deborah Taylor says the book shows Puerto Rico as it is not often seen. For VOA Learning English, I'm Carla Babb.
This is the VOA Special English Education Report. More than 600 delegates recently met in Burkina Faso to discuss education in Africa. The aim is to find ways to support economic growth by improving education and job training programs. The delegates included education ministers and representatives of civil society, business, labor, and youth groups. The meeting, held every 3 years, is known as the Triennial. Alan Beal Kataria is Executive Secretary of the Association for the Development of Education in Africa. His group organized the week-long conference. He says there is a missing link between education and employment in Africa. For example, schools need to improve technical training for students who do not continue to secondary education. Mr. Beal Kataria says educational programs need to be reshaped to better fit the needs of employers. He says this is already happening in some countries, including Tunisia, where the association is based. For instance, where they have to train engineers, there is a lot of discussion between the schools and the companies in order to know the demands of the company, to take them into account in the curriculum and even in the management of the schools. In Mali, an association of artisans is working to improve the skills of mechanics, woodworkers, and tradesmen. That association has also helped workers and companies to win government contracts. Several West African countries are working together to develop a network of trade and vocational schools. The idea is based in part on a successful example developed by Nigeria. Mr. Beal Kataria says educators are working to connect government-run school systems with other groups that are helping educate students. These include non-governmental organizations, community literacy centers, and faith-based groups. Among these groups are Islamic schools or madrasas that are expanding what they teach. Another subject for the conference was peace education. The idea grew out of the violence in Kenya related to elections in 2007. The idea of peace education has since spread to countries including Rwanda, Somalia, Ivory Coast, Sierra Leone, and Liberia. New technology offers a way for Africans living elsewhere in the world, the African diaspora, to aid development in their home country. For example, a professor could use video conferencing to teach a class back home. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal.
I'm Carolyn Prasuti with the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. White rice is the world's most popular form of rice, but it goes through a milling process that removes many nutrients. As a result, people who eat a poor diet based on white rice may not get enough vitamin A. Each year, an estimated 250,000 to 500,000 children go blind from vitamin A deficiency. The World Health Organization says half of them die within a year of losing their sight. Vitamin A deficiency is a problem, especially in Africa and Southeast Asia. So scientists thought of an answer. They combined white rice with plant compounds that the body can change into vitamin A. The rice contains beta carotene and other carotenoids. These plant colorings give the rice a golden color. The scientists also thought of a plan to give away this golden rice for free to poor farmers. But the rice is genetically engineered. They say it cannot be made using traditional methods to breed plants. The scientists worked for 10 years until 1990 to develop the technology to add genes to rice. Then it took 9 more years to get the genes they wanted into the seed. The first field test took place in 2004 at Louisiana State University in the United States. Golden rice is currently being tested in the Philippines. It is still not available for general use. Co-inventor Ingo Patricus says rice with 2 added genes will be available in the year 2013. One gene comes from maize or corn, and the other from a soil bacterium. Mr. Patricus is retired from the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology. He blames the delays on too many rules about genetically modified crops. Opponents say such crops may cause environmental damage by breeding with conventional plants. Opponents also question the safety of biotech foods. Mr. Patricus says golden rice has never been shown to be unsafe for the environment or people. Many agriculture organizations support the project. But there are also critics, including researchers, for the environmental group Greenpeace. Several months ago, they questioned whether golden rice could do much for vitamin A deficiency. They said releasing genetically modified rice in Asia could permanently change traditional rice varieties and wild ancestors of rice. For VOA Special English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti. For more news about rice research, go to voaspecialenglish.com.
I'm Alex Villarreal with the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. Sub-Saharan Africa has the world's highest hunger rate. The United Nations says 30% of the people were undernourished last year. But a new report says African farmers also have ideas that could help the world fight hunger and poverty. Danielle Nierenberg from the World Watch Institute in Washington spent a year visiting 25 countries south of the Sahara. In Nairobi, Kenya, for example, Ms. Nierenberg found women farmers growing vegetables just outside their doorsteps in the Kibera settlement. She says the area is crowded, dirty, and noisy. But the people are finding ways to make their lives better. The women use old sacks filled with soil. They cut holes in the sides of the tall bags so air gets to the seeds. The women feed the vegetables to their families and sell their surplus. They use the money to send their children to school. Last year, an estimated 925 million people worldwide did not get enough to eat. Half of all people in the world now live in and around cities. Researchers like Ms. Nierenberg are looking increasingly at creative ideas to feed those who are malnourished. She said there are a lot of lessons that people in the Western world can learn from Africa. And what they are doing can be done in other developing countries. Farmers in the developing world lose between 20 and 40% of their harvest before it ever reaches market. Asma Latif from the group Bread for the World says there are many reasons why food gets wasted. Farmers are without electricity and cold storage. They lack good seeds and fertilizer. They lack good roads. Ms. Latif says conditions like these keep small farmers in poverty. Danielle Nierenberg says more attention needs to be paid to protecting harvests. In Nigeria, village processing centers are helping farmers reduce their losses and earn more money. The centers process cassava, a root vegetable, into basic food products. In Uganda, the World Watch report says some schools are teaching children how to grow local crops. And in South Africa and Kenya, the report praises the breeding of local kinds of livestock. These animals may produce less milk or meat than other breeds, but they can survive heat and drought conditions. The report is called State of the World 2011, Innovations That Nourish the Planet. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal.
This is the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. Rice hulls, or husks, are the protective coverings on grains of rice. Rice with just its hull removed is brown rice. Rice without its hull, or bran, is white rice. Once rice is harvested, the hulls are out of a job. They may be taken to landfills or burned. Sometimes they are used to absorb waste in chicken houses. Other times, they are used to amend soil. But a chemist in Texas has another idea. Rajan Vempati led a group that developed a new process to make rice hulls into ash. The idea is to replace some of the Portland cement traditionally used in making concrete. Portland cement is a material that holds together the sand and crushed stone in concrete. Rajan Vempati thinks rice hull ash could help the concrete industry produce less carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is released in cement manufacturing when fuel is burned and limestone is heated. The Portland Cement Association says the gas from the limestone is reabsorbed as concrete ages. But cement manufacturing produces around 5% of the carbon dioxide released by human activity worldwide. Carbon dioxide is one of the gases that may affect the climate by trapping heat. The process for making rice hull ash heats the hulls to 800 degrees centigrade. Carbon is driven out and fine particles of almost pure silica remain. The process releases some carbon dioxide, but Rajan Vempati says it would be reabsorbed into the soil naturally. Another inventor, Prasad Rangaraju, is an engineer at Clemson University in South Carolina. He tested the cement and says less could be used because the rice hull ash makes it a stronger building material. Also, the inventors say the light-colored material better reflects sunlight, so buildings would cost less to cool. The National Ready Mixed Concrete Association points out that using ash in cement is not a new idea. The ancient Romans discovered that volcanic ash made better cement. But the modern inventors say rice hull ash works better than other materials. They developed the process with money from the National Science Foundation. They have not yet brought it to market. Rice hull ash is already available, but the product is relatively costly. Cost, including transportation, may decide the success of the new technology. Using it could make the most sense in areas where farmers grow lots of rice and the hulls might just go to waste. And that's the VOA Special English Agriculture Report.
This is the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. Seth DeBolt is a plant scientist at the University of Kentucky in the United States. He and other scientists wanted to find a source of fuel that poor people in rural areas of developing countries could use to make electricity. The United Nations Development Program says 1.5 billion people have no electricity. 1 billion others have an undependable supply. Professor DeBolt went on a study trip to rural Indonesia. He saw that everywhere he went, there was very little waste in the use of agricultural products. Everything that farmers grew was used for something. Even the remains of fruit that people did not eat were fed to chickens. Little waste meant there was little that could be used for fuel. Growing a separate fuel crop would take land away from food crops. That was something Professor DeBolt did not want to do. He says the people at most risk of energy poverty are often the same people who have food insecurity issues as well. Any change in food availability would hurt that group the most. But he found two items that were in plentiful supply and would not create competition between food and fuel. Coconut shells and mango pits are generally thrown out. Yet Professor DeBolt says they have a lot of energy stored in them. He says they have an excellent heating value, which he compares to coal of low to moderate grade. The same is true for the pit of an olive, peach, or cherry, or the shell of an almond or walnut. All someone needs is a way to release that energy. Seth DeBolt says a company in India, Husk Power Systems, is using small generators in villages to make electricity from rice hulls. The process used is called gasification. Heating plant matter in a low oxygen chamber releases gases. These can be burned in an engine that turns a power generating turbine. Professor DeBolt says he and his team see possibilities for coconut and mango power. They published a study in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. It says these small-scale production systems could provide as much as 13% of the energy needs of a country like Indonesia. Other tropical countries with large crops of coconuts, mangoes, and similar fruit could benefit as well. But Professor DeBolt says this is not a perfect solution. There are technical questions, like how to safely deal with the hazardous waste that gasification can produce. And there needs to be money to get these projects started. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Agriculture Report in Special English. Gordon Sato traveled to Eritrea for the first time in 1985. The Japanese-American cell biologist wanted to see what he could do to help the people in their struggle for independence from Ethiopia. On his trip, he noticed that camels were eating the leaves of mangrove trees growing along the coast. he planted more mangroves so they could be used to feed livestock. But at first, all the new trees died. Then Gordon Sato observed that mangrove trees only grew naturally where there was fresh water some of the time. The fresh water provided minerals that salt water lacked. Gordon Sato found a way to provide these minerals. He put nitrogen, phosphorus, and iron into small plastic bags at the base of each tree. Holes in the bags released the minerals into the soil over time. The women in the village of Hargigo started to feed the leaves of the mangroves to their sheep and goats. But the animals were not producing enough milk for their babies. Gordon Sato asked the villagers to grind the remains of fish and spread this fish paste on the leaves. This provided protein for the sheep and goats so they could produce more milk. Today, there are more than 1 million mangrove trees around the village. Gordon Sato has also started a large garden in Mauritania to grow more mangrove trees. He says, "You don't have to be brilliant to do useful work. All you have is moderate intelligence and determination, and you can make a contribution to this world." Gordon Sato called his work in Eritrea the Mansonar Project. The name is meant to honor Japanese Americans placed in the Mansonar relocation camp in California during World War II. For VOA Learning English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti.
I'm Alex Villarreal with the VOA Special English Agriculture Report. Farmers and gardeners have turned the soil for centuries, but many now believe in no-till or reduced tillage, a method also called conservation tillage. The Conservation Technology Information Center says 40% of American cropland used this method at last report. Tilling can remove weeds and the waste from last season's crops and help break down old plant material into fertilizer. But it can also increase the risk of soil erosion by rain or wind. Tilling also releases carbon dioxide from the soil into the atmosphere. No-till keeps carbon in the soil and avoids the release of heat-trapping gases from motorized equipment. It also keeps water in the soil and protects helpful organisms like earthworms. And it saves money on labor, machinery, and fuel. A recent study reported on almost 20 years of different tillage methods in the American states of Colorado, Kansas, and Nebraska. The researchers say tillage makes soil less resistant to being broken apart by raindrops. They say no-till stores more soil carbon, which helps the soil particles stick together. They found that the first 2.5 centimeters of topsoil are up to 7 times stronger against rain than plowed soil. The study also noted that when tilled soil particles come in contact with air, soil organic matter is lost through the process of oxidation. The findings appeared in the Soil Science Society of America journal. Another recent study found that a single tillage does not harm yield or soil structure in land that is normally not tilled. Charles Wortman at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln says a one-time tillage may be used to correct a problem, like aggressive weeds. His 5-year study appeared in the Agronomy Journal. Fabian Fernandez, a soil and plant nutrition expert at the University of Illinois, says no-till means less intensive labor. But he also says it does not mean an end to preparing the ground for planting. Jimmy Wagner works at the American Plant Garden Center in Bethesda, Maryland. He says hand tools like tilling forks, shovels, and thatching rakes require more work than a rotary tiller, but they work well and cost less. If you till, wait until the soil is warm and dry enough. If the soil stays together in a ball, it is too wet to till. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal. You can find more agriculture reports at voaspecialenglish.com.